Eventually the movie got made, but right to the end, nobody really had any confidence in the movie at all. I would say they obviously didn't think it was going to do any business. And I must say, I couldn't get anybody on the phone. I mean, I would try and ring and sort of find people 2 weeks before the release of the film, and it was horrendous.
You know, you go through periods on a movie where you say, oh, we're making the worst movie ever. We look at sequences that were so long and they got very boring, or the dailies got boring. But when you started to put together, and we had Bud Smith, who was one of the greatest editors ever, because we had a very short post, and so he really didn't have much time to cut the movie, and they were working around the clock.
It was one of those killer schedules. I mean, by having two editors, myself and Walt Mulconery, we had three assistants and two apprentices too, because we were working around the clock. We worked, I think it was 72 days and nights without stopping.
Adrian shoots an enormous amount of film. He uses a number of cameras because he had those big dance sequences. So he'd have two, three, four cameras on those dance sequences. So they'd go through all those film, sync it up, look at everything, and try to get a sequence cut together. And then Adrian would come in the room and throw it all out and start all over again.
But it had to be tight. You know, we couldn't let this film go on and on and on lengthwise. So it finally became Jerry Bruckheimer and Don Simpson with Adrian, all of them into the editing room and deciding what we had to take out.
And what we wanted to do is take the audience or take the character down as far as you could take her. She lost her aunt, the one who was her advisor through the picture. And we just kept diving her down further and further and further. So when she started to come up, it was the emotional outburst at the end was so much stronger. And that's what I think really pushed us over the top. And a lot of scenes came out that were interfering with her own personal arc.
I remember sitting in the preview theater with my assistant, with Casey Silva. We both thought this was a disaster. You know, I said, is there any way I can get out of the theater without being seen? Because all of the executives were behind. And at about exactly that moment, the audience started laughing at something, and then at something else, and I sort of realized that they liked it.
Well, miracles do happen, I guess.
And the results of this preview were terrific. I mean, the numbers were very good. And I remember there was a lot of people at the studio who thought that we'd fiddle the results. They thought that the people in the theater were our friends who were writing nice stuff about it. So nobody knew that it would do any business.
I think the picture was universally panned. One journalist critic called it a toxic waste dump. And a number of years later, he re-reviewed the picture and said, I missed it. I really didn't get it. But the kids got it, and the public got it.
I framed two reviews side by side. One review said, don't look for advertising on this film, just look for strategic signs of pollution. That was one review. The other one, next to it, was that it was the state of the art of filmmaking at that time. So I put them both up, because they're both nonsense.
Opening weekend, and Don and I go to Westwood in Los Angeles, and there was one big theater, I think it was the Village where it opened in, and right across the street was a record store. The kids would walk out of the theater, go to the record store, buy the album, which was gone in an hour. The Polygram only shipped 60,000, so they really had no faith in the record. It took them 2 or 3 weeks to replenish the stock, and went from the record store back into the theater. So it was like a loop. They'd see the movie 2-3 times.
It's interesting, it did $4 million for the weekend, I remember this. And that was sort of about the minimum you needed for a hit, right? And it just sat from April to September and did exactly the same amount. It didn't get, I think it went up a little bit maybe, but it pretty much stayed at the same level. It didn't fall off. You know, movies always fall off. And this thing just sat there. It's funny.
You know, I'd still be living in a small apartment in Hollywood if it was based on the reviews of our movies, and especially Flashdance. But it's the public that speaks. They got to sit there and pay their hard-earned money to be entertained by us. And if we get it right, like we did in Flashdance, they'll come back over and over again.
It was that weird thing where you walk in anonymous, and you walk out and everyone's staring at you. It was odd. It was wonderful.
Well, it just shows that sometimes they work great and sometimes they don't work great. This is one that just happened to work really brilliantly by Adrian's direction and believing in the film from Jerry Bruckheimer and Don Simpson, and then hiring me to kind of shepherd the film on to the finish. And so therefore you feel very complete when you finally get nominated and you win a British Academy Award. The only thing I wish I'd have gotten was the Academy Award. Then my whole career would have been totally complete.
We certainly were a little surprised how big the movie became and how much the music worked and how well it worked. Plus, we went to number one with the album, and you know, the first awards started to come in. And finally, I thought maybe after winning the Golden Globes, maybe we have a chance for the Oscar, and it won.
I think all of the songs had a place because it also won a Grammy for a really good album as a soundtrack album. In those days, they didn't exactly win that easily.
Somebody rang me up from New York and said that he said, you know, they're dancing in the aisles, he said, in Times Square. He said, you have to come, he said. They get up in the middle of the movie and they dance around in the aisles, and they were, you know.
It was the beginning of a whole world for women going to the movies, and for everyone who was disempowered from believing that they had a chance to chase their dreams. And it had so much power in what it was trying to express that it just was like a nuclear missile.
Unhappily, a number of people who I worked with on this movie, like Don Simpson, who I miss enormously, Dawn Steele, also, who I miss enormously, played like a huge part in this film. Sonny Johnson now isn't with us anymore, you know, who played Jeannie. So that's sad, and I miss them like crazy, actually, I really do.
Dawn got sick, and she was eventually diagnosed with brain cancer. And when I think about Flashdance, I can't think about it without thinking about Dawn.
The young girls who were touched by this movie are now moms. And so I will run into these moms from time to time. And this movie has touched people in such a wonderful, special way. I'm very proud to have been part of it.
Don't you understand? When you give up your dream, you die.
And it's corny, but it's kind of true, you know? And I think that's why people took to the movie. In fact, people wrote to me afterwards and said that it had an effect on their life. And, you know, they were doing a job that they loathed, and it made them go out and try and do the job that they wanted to do.
Oh, lady, 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 lady. Those images on that screen, the girl with those big, dark brown eyes, and those wonderful dances, and the sexiness of the movie, is something you want to relive, and the music, of course, you know, stays with you.